Quest presents an unabridged recording of Out of My Depth by David Leigh and Anne Darwin, narrated by Anne Dover.
Dedication for Mark and Anthony, with love and gratitude. Foreword. In 30 years working as a journalist, I've covered some amazing stories across the world. But in terms of sheer breathtaking audacity, none come remotely close to the incredible globe-trotting antics of the seemingly most ordinary of couples from the seaside town of Seaton Carew on England's northeast coast. Mother of two, Anne Darwin, is a softly spoken and unassuming former doctor's receptionist who helped her now infamous canoe man husband John pull off one of the most brazen frauds you're ever likely to read about. Little did I know that when I knocked on the door of a fourth-story apartment in Panama, Central America, shortly before Christmas in December 2007, I would play a central role in uncovering a gobsmacking transatlantic adventure that quite literally beggars belief. Anne's often heart-wrenching story is one of extreme regret, remorse, shame, and finally, redemption. She deserves great credit for being brave enough to tell her side of a story that engrossed millions of people across the world, but that left her in the very depths of despair. David Leigh. Prologue. Seaton Carew, March 22, 2002. Feeling the chill of the evening drawing in as their lifeboats churned through the waves, the men who had been scouring the North Sea for almost 18 hours were growing increasingly tired and frustrated. A lot of things weren't making much sense that day, yet still they refused to give up hope. "Come on," they muttered to themselves under their breath. "Where the hell is this guy?" Approaching dusk on a still March evening, they were all too aware that as the light faded, so did their hopes of success. Including land-based support crew, some 65 Royal National Lifeboat Institution volunteers were involved in a massive sea search, one of the biggest off the northeast coast of England in years. 6 rescue boats using tried and tested search patterns, methodically crisscrossing 200 square miles of ocean for any trace of a local man last seen paddling out to sea in a red canoe. Worryingly, he was apparently heading towards the mouth of the River Tees, one of the busiest shipping channels in the United Kingdom. The possibility of a gruesome death sucked into a ship's propellers could not be ruled out. No one wanted to admit it, but they all knew that the outcome of the rescue mission was looking bleaker by the minute. Spotters screwed up their eyes in the vain hope it might help them to see something. But there was nothing to be seen. Nothing at all. According to the local news, everyone was puzzled. It had been a textbook operation in what the men considered ideal rescue conditions, only partly cloudy, with a sea state of 2 to 3, meaning only a gentle swell, with no hint of the mountainous waves or icy conditions they so often had to contend with. It was, they all agreed, the perfect day for a rescue. So where was he? The operation, being coordinated by the Humber Coast Guard, had grown steadily in scale throughout the day. 3 aircraft had been called in to assist. A bright yellow Royal Air Force Sea King search and rescue helicopter, a small fixed-wing Cleveland police spotter plane, and an RAF Nimrod reconnaissance aircraft. Even a Royal Navy warship, HMS Explorer, which happened to be in the area on exercise, had joined the search, all surely adding, rescuers felt, to the chances of success. Dozens of RNLI and Coast Guard shore teams were combing the coastline for debris, or worse. Nothing was being left to chance. Shortly after lunch, at 1:15 p.m., there was finally a breakthrough when a double-ended paddle, typically used by canoeists, was retrieved from the sea near North Gare, just a mile or two along the coast from Seton Carew, the little seaside town from where the missing man was seen paddling off the previous day. But if as feared it was his, it could mean he'd been left at the mercy of the sea and the notoriously strong tidal currents that could quickly have dragged him out towards the shipping lanes. It didn't look good. As the hour approached 6 p.m, the men who had worked in shifts throughout the day and the previous night were weary through lack of sleep. But it was the worry that somehow someone had missed something, maybe the tiniest of clues, that bothered them most. Back at Redcar HQ, wives and girlfriends had been to the local Asda supermarket to stock up on pies and sandwiches, for it wasn't just the boats that needed refueling. They brewed piping hot tea and coffee for the men who'd put their day jobs on hold to join the search. Some of the more experienced hands had niggling doubts about their mission, wondering if perhaps there was a little more to this disappearance than met the eye. There hadn't been a single sighting of either the missing man or wreckage from his canoe, and they were baffled. The nagging doubts continued, but each and every man was well aware of the RNLI ethic that call-outs are never criticised, no matter how suspicious they may appear, for fear of dissuading future callers. Their job was to save lives, and, acutely aware the missing man was a local, said to be about 50 years old, with a wife and probably a family at home, worrying themselves sick and hoping against hope for the miracle they too were praying for, they tried to push such thoughts to the back of their minds. The boatmen had all been involved in rescue operations before, and some recalled previous occasions when, just as they had all but given up hope, their luck had suddenly changed and they had plucked a fortunate soul to safety from the unforgiving sea. But as the night began to draw in along the Cleveland coastline, most were beginning to fear in their hearts that it was not destined to be one of those days. Folk taking a late afternoon stroll along the promenade in Seton Carew stopped to lean against the blue-painted iron balustrades and gaze out to the cold and grey North Sea. In the distance, and through the haze thrown skywards by the surf's spray, rising up and merging into the smoke billowing out of the giant oil refineries and nuclear power station at the mouth of the River Tees, they could just about make out the outlines of some of the rescue boats involved in a search that was making headlines in newspapers and on local television and radio stations. The talk of the town in the pubs and hotels, fish and chip shops, and seafront stores selling candy floss and brightly coloured sticks of rock was of nothing else. "Any news on that bloke who went out in his canoe?" countless customers asked the shopkeepers.
"No, nothing. It's not looking good," they were each told, as the sound of the rescue aircraft lingered in the distance.
Looking out from the drawing room window of her Victorian seafront home, watching the flashing lights from the massive search operation underway, Anne Darwin was a nervous wreck. She knew very well the brave men and women risking their lives looking for her missing husband were not going to find him that night, the next, or any time soon. She thought to herself, "What the hell have I done?" Here, for the first time, Anne tells her extraordinary and heart-wrenching story. Chapter 1. Courtship and Marriage. Horse and carts were still a common sight on the streets when I was growing up in the seaside mining villages of Hawden and Blackhall Colliery, on the northeast shoulder of England. Hawden Colliery was one of the biggest mines in the country, employing thousands of workers, and at its height, producing more than 1.5 million tonnes of coal a year. It was known as the jewel in the crown of the British coal mining industry. Today, of course, the mines are long since closed, and the villages of my childhood on the shores of the North Sea
have changed beyond all recognition. For a start, they're an awful lot cleaner. It wasn't until I was 15 that I even realised Starlings weren't always jet black. The only ones I'd ever seen in my early years were always coated in soot from sitting on the chimneys of the villagers' terraced homes, and I didn't know they could actually be speckled. But then, few things in our villages escaped the dust and soot that constantly billowed from the chimneys. Such was the life of communities that had been home to generations of mining families. I was born on the 3rd of July 1952 in Hartlepool and christened Anne Catherine. My dad, Henry Stevenson, known as Harry, worked at the mine from leaving school as a young boy. He trained originally as a blacksmith and later as a welder, and worked mainly on the surface, but occasionally had to go underground to repair machinery. My mam, Catherine, known as Kathleen, was a full-time mother to me and Michael, who was 3 years older than me. My sister Christine was born 9 years later. When Mam left school, she looked after her ailing mother. She didn't have the chance to work. Until I was 3, we lived in Blackhall Colliery, and then we moved to the neighbouring village of Horden, where my parents were given the opportunity of living in a colliery house that was more suitable for a growing family. It was from here that my early memories come. Monday was always washing day, with the ironing sometimes spilling over into Tuesday. There was a washing line in the yard for drying the clothes, so they always smelled fresh. Although having coal fires was a problem, as often soot fell from the chimneys onto the washing. We had an indoor line in the kitchen where the ironing would hang to be aired before being folded and put away the next day. Friday was the day for doing the housework. Mam started upstairs and worked her way down, dusting, hoovering, polishing and cleaning windows. As I grew older, I was encouraged to help, and it was rewarding to see the shiny surfaces reappear from beneath the dust. Mam had crocheted doilies on her dressing table. I very carefully lifted them off to reveal the pattern they left behind before dusting it away. Grandma, Dad's mother, usually came to visit on a Friday. She stayed for tea and sometimes gave us a sixpence or a shilling when she left to go home. When we first moved to Horden, Grandma and Granda lived just a short walk away. They moved to a modern house in the new town of Peterlee when we were still quite young. That's when her Friday visits became part of our routine. She was a plump lady, and I loved to sit on her knee for cuddles. Grandad was a blacksmith at Horden Colliery. When he retired, he spent time in his garden, growing roses. My favourite was the variety called Blue Moon. To me, it looked so exotic. The week usually began with doing the shopping on Saturday, and sometimes we'd go for a walk with Kim, our Manchester Terrier. I loved to go through the bluebell woods in spring. Originally belonging to Grandma and Grandad, we had Kim for 14 years. Sunday was the one day when we ate in the front room. It was a roast dinner, of course, followed by homemade rice pudding with a skin on top. Delicious. Mam cooked it on the gas stove in the kitchen, moving the whistling kettle out of the way, and my brother Michael and I helped by shelling peas and peeling vegetables, sitting at the kitchen table or in the one armchair. There was a set pot in the corner, built from brick. It was a big pot over a coal fire and heated the room and water for baths and washing clothes. Kim was often lying on the hearth rug in front. In the morning we'd have been to church, where we always wore our Sunday best. For me, this included a hat and gloves, even in the summer, when I'd wear lace gloves. And my Easter present was always a new hat. The afternoon was spent playing or listening to the radiogram, or later, watching the television, while Mam baked pies and cakes for tea. When she called, "Who wants to clean the bowl?" We race to scrape out the remains of the cake mixture from the bowl, and I sometimes cut out the scones. There were happy times, with simple pleasures. Like another world now. We used a little tin bath in front of the kitchen fire each night, always hoping no one needed to pass through the kitchen to use the outside toilet. Once a week, the long bath was dragged in from the yard for us all to use. It felt like luxury to be able to sit in and stretch out. The downside was the time it took to fill it from the set pot and to empty it. Bath time often felt quite awkward when I was a girl in her early teens. It wasn't until we moved again when I was 15 that we had the convenience of a modern bathroom. The houses had a yard at the back with an outside toilet and coal house. There was little traffic about, and we played outside in the long terraced streets. We occasionally had to stop what we were doing when a horse and cart needed to pass along the road to make doorstep deliveries. It was only a short walk to the local park, where we played on the swings and slides and roundabouts. The Catholic infant and junior school was next to the church we attended. My first classroom had a high ceiling and a coal fire in one corner, which always roared away in winter. We sat either side of long tables rather than at desks. These were the days when Nitty Nora visited the schools on a regular basis to inspect the children's heads. What sticks in my memory was the toilet block in the yard. It fascinated me that the toilets graduated in size, one for each year group. There was a separate playground for boys and girls, boys preferring to kick footballs and the girls using skipping ropes or trying to juggle with three balls, singing rhymes and chasing each other. One year we had an open-air concert of singing and dancing in the school playground. The parish priest came, and all our families were there to watch. It was a glorious summer day. During the summer months, we often went to Crimdon Beach. We met Auntie Mary and Uncle Jim and our two cousins and played beach ball, rounders, piggyback races, and jumped over the waves. We sometimes went to the pavilion where we bought chips or ice cream. But more often than not, we walked to Auntie Mary's house in Blackhall Colliery for tea before going home to Horton, exhausted after a long day in the sun. We hadn't heard of skin cancer and always suffered from sunburn. Occasionally, my other uncle and granddad came too. My mum's father lived with Auntie Mary, as did her brother. Granddad was from Ireland and worked as a miner at Blackhall. His wife, who I was named after, had died before I was born. Every summer holiday, we went away for a week to Scarborough with Auntie Mary, Uncle Jim and our cousins. We travelled either by train or coach, and we always stayed in the same guest house. It felt like going home. Everything was so familiar, and just a short walk from the beach. Holidays were always good fun. We got to spend more time with Dad. I was too young to be aware of it, but the mines were producing too much coal and there were not enough people who wanted to buy it. For many mining families, wages all but dried up as Horden Colliery's management drastically cut back on overheads and shut the pits for 3 weeks in every month. Many miners either moved away or tried to find work in the heavy industries of Hartlepool, Middlesbrough or Sunderland. My father stuck it out. All I knew about it was that there was never very much money. Mam was always waiting for the next payday. But there was home-cooked food on the table and we never went without life's necessities. My Auntie Mary used to sew. She often made me dresses and Mam would knit. When I was 11 years old, I sat an entrance exam to attend St. Joseph's Convent Grammar School in Hartlepool. I remember feeling greatly relieved to pass and was excited to be able to go. We were taught by nuns and had to wear a stuffy old-fashioned uniform of dark brown tunic, cream blouse and a blue, brown and gold tie and hat. I joined the school choir and discovered I loved singing.
and once a year there was an annual theatre production where I was involved, usually as part of the choir or the chorus. I was an average student. It was the practical subjects I enjoyed. I learned to sew and started to make my own clothes. And when I reached the sixth form, I found I had an aptitude for shorthand and typing. As a child, I wanted to be an air hostess or a nurse. But as a teenager, I decided on office work and wanted to be a secretary. My one special friend was Kathleen, who I met when I started grammar school. We would talk of being married and living next door to each other and raising our children together. She followed the Sunderland football team, and I occasionally went to home matches with her. We both enjoyed Irish ceilidh dancing, and this is how we spent most Sunday evenings, travelling to the local parishes, who took it in turns to host the dancers. It could be exhausting, but it was always enjoyable. Neither me nor Kathleen were particular fans of wearing makeup. We were quite reserved and didn't do the girly things. I had long, dark hair, and it was mini skirts with flat shoes for the ceilidhs, occasionally a maxi dress if it was a Christmas do. Mum and Dad's pleasure was dancing too. Old-time ballroom dancing on a Saturday evening. Occasionally I went with them if there was a special dance on. One particular week was the choosing of Miss Blackhall. I went along to be a spectator and have a couple of dances with my dad. When it came to the judging, the girls were invited to walk around the room in a circle. I was just sitting watching, with no intention of participating whatsoever. Someone came round asking me and others sitting down if we'd join in. I refused, but they said, "Please get up, we need to make up the numbers." So with encouragement from my mum and dad, I did. To my surprise, I was chosen to be Miss Blackhall. I won £10, was presented with a silver cup, and had my picture in the local paper. The only duty was to appear in another parade in the holiday camp at Crimdon Dean the following summer, with all the winners from the surrounding villages. But I didn't win anything there. I was 16 when I had my first boyfriend, and was heartbroken that he ended the relationship when he went to college. It was an innocent relationship, which I think lasted almost a year, but it will always be special, because it was the first. A couple of years passed before I had another boyfriend. Then a few followed in fairly quick succession. I didn't enjoy going to pubs, and I couldn't see anything meaningful developing with any of them. John Darwin and I first crossed paths on the bus going to our respective grammar schools. John was 2 years older than me and went to St. Francis's Roman Catholic Grammar School. We always acknowledged one another, but often with nothing more than a nod of the head as John boarded the bus in the next village. That was as far as it went. John later told me that I often caught his eye, but I never really gave him much thought. He wasn't really good-looking and was a little too cocksure of himself for my liking. One day he knocked off my school hat on the bus, and I quickly turned round and glared at him. John just laughed. He left school when I was 14 to attend a college in Teesside, where he studied for A-levels before going to teach a training college in Manchester. He was later taken on as a maths, science and religious studies teacher in Ledgate near Consett in County Durham. I didn't see him during this time, apart from the odd Sunday morning at church when he'd come over and talk to me after Mass. My parents were friendly with John's, having known them throughout their lives. His dad had been a bricklayer for the council but was now retired. His mam was a cook at Hartlepool General Hospital, preparing the meals for special diets. I took a Sunday job in the sweet shop next to John's house when I was 16. It was a 5-minute walk from where we now lived in the coastal village of Blackhall Rocks. John would often come in and pass the time of day. He was cheeky and self-assured and frequently asked me out, but I always said no,
Because he was 2 years older than me, I didn't feel comfortable about going out with him, and I didn't feel good enough. I suppose I was a bit in awe of him. My only encounters with teachers had been as a pupil. I wasn't really attracted to him either. He was taller than me, but slightly built, which is probably why he had the nickname Dinky. I actually never knew his first name until after our first date. He had a mop of curly hair, a bit like Jimi Hendrix's. John could be very persuasive and charming, and he didn't seem to be put off no matter how many times I said no. He always asked for sweets from the top shelf, knowing I would have to climb a ladder to get them. Leaving school at 17, with qualifications in shorthand and typing, I landed a job as a typist at a printing firm in Hartlepool, William Barlow and Son. I continued studying at night school and gained English O-level and higher speeds in shorthand and typing. I was lucky to get a job so quickly, and it felt good to be earning my own money, even if it was less than £5 a week. I gave some money to Mam, paid my own bus fares, and still managed to save a little each week. After countless times asking me to go out with him, I eventually agreed. I was 20. On our first date, we went to a bowling alley in Billingham with a young married couple who had a baby. I hadn't met them before. Martin had been to college with John, so it was an anxious evening for me. But it was a good night. I felt I shouldn't have worried about not being an equal, just because he'd been to college and I hadn't. We could still have fun together. I wasn't expecting a long-term relationship, but after that first time, we began seeing each other quite regularly. We used to walk for miles at Blackhall or Crimdon, over the cliffs or along the beach. We were officially an item, and family and friends suspected it wouldn't be long before they heard the sound of wedding bells. John had a good sense of humour and was attentive. He told me stories of his childhood adventures with his brother or his friends. Always one for loving the outdoors, he grew up as a bit of a daredevil. They went off to the beach to spend the day, lighting fires, cooking potatoes in the embers, climbing rocks and playing in the caves. For me, he made romantic gestures, like collecting heart-shaped stones from the beach when we were out walking. One summer's evening, John drove us to a pub in Dalton Piercy, where after a few drinks he asked me to marry him. There was nothing overly romantic about his proposal, but I had half expected it and said yes. I'd always wanted to be married and to have a family. I'm sure I loved the thought of being married far more than I actually loved John, but I was very happy. We married later that same year at St. Joseph's Catholic Church in Blackhall Colliery on the 22nd of December 1973. It was a small wedding, just family and friends, about 60 of us in total. Christine, now 12 years old, was a bridesmaid, and Kathleen, my friend from school, was a chief bridesmaid. I wore a white dress with lace trim, a veil and headdress, and carried a bouquet of red roses. Straight after the wedding, we were driven to Newcastle Airport and flew to Magaluf in Mallorca for our honeymoon. It was the first time I'd ever flown. We spent the evenings in the company of a young couple from Newcastle. John and I went on a few trips organised by the hotel to take in the local culture or walked along the beach. The sea was bright and blue, not like the cold, grey North Sea of home. On returning, we stayed with my mum and dad for a couple of days before moving into the house John already owned. 187 Durham Road, Leadgate. It was a Victorian terraced house with high ceilings. It had originally been a three-bedroom house, but one bedroom had been converted into a bathroom, and there were two reception rooms and a kitchen downstairs. It had a coal fire in the room at the rear of the house
and a gas fire in the front sitting room. There was a yard at the back with an outside toilet and coal store and a pretty little garden at the front. John's parents had provided the deposit, as they did again later with his first car, a dark green Hillman Imp. John had lived there for a few months, going home to Blackhall for the weekends, but he didn't have much in the way of home comforts, so we gathered bits and pieces of furniture together and moved in on the 6th of January, 1974. Chapter 2. Confronting John's Mistress. To be married and living in my own home was everything I'd ever dreamed of, and John and I talked excitedly about having children to make our family complete. But while I was perfectly content, I quickly discovered that John was never quite satisfied with his lot. I had to leave my job in Hartlepool, as it was too far to travel from Ledgate. I'd risen through the ranks to become secretary to the deputy managing director, and now found a job as a secretary at Shotley Bridge General Hospital. Although we were both earning a fair wage, money was still tight, and I repeatedly told John not to be so foolish when he said he wanted me to have the best of everything. To me, it really didn't matter if we went without the latest washer or television, but it clearly mattered to John. When we were first married, we had mostly second-hand furniture donated by friends and relatives, which we gradually replaced when we could afford to buy new. Not like today, when young couples have fully furnished homes before getting married. But since his late teens, John had been desperate to break away from his working-class roots and the stigma, as he saw it, of council homes and being poor. I remember going to buy a washing machine and choosing one that was middle of the range, but John suggested a much more expensive model. It appeared to me to have an excessive amount of programmes that I would never use, but he said, "If you have this one, at least you'll always have the option to use them. Buy a cheaper one and you won't have that choice." Which was a fair comment, but to me it was still an unnecessary expense. Yet, after some debate, we bought the more expensive one. I was quickly learning what John wanted, he usually got. I remembered just before we were married, when I was promoted at work, John's dad Ronnie saying, "Oh, that's much better, isn't it, to be able to tell people you're a secretary?" Social standing meant a lot to him. He always wanted to stand out from the crowd. Thinking about it now, perhaps John's need for the best came from his dad. Ronnie, originally a builder's labourer, had been determined to make something of himself and had no intention of leading what he considered to be the grimy life of a miner. He had married well, to a girl who lived in one of Blackhall's posh private houses. According to his family, John was later brought up in an atmosphere of money, money, money. That's what mattered above anything else. At the time, I discovered that if we talked about something we liked at his parents' house, John's mam sometimes gave him the money. Unknown to his dad, she said, "Go and get what you want." I soon learnt not to mention things we'd quite like if she was in earshot. It made me feel uncomfortable to be always taking money. It was still early days in our marriage when, out of nowhere, he dropped a bombshell, the prospect of which terrified me. "Why don't we up sticks and emigrate to Australia?" There were plenty of opportunities for qualified young teachers, he said, and I would easily find secretarial work, and we could start a new life in the sun. I was horrified. It wasn't something I had ever given any thought to. I told John I'd miss my parents and friends, and was very happy and content with the way things were. As a concession, I did say, "Perhaps later, in a few years." Thankfully, for once, he didn't press the matter. I didn't have the slightest desire to go anywhere, let alone thousands of miles away to the other side of the world. In 1974, I got the news I had been praying for when I fell pregnant, but was devastated when I miscarried. John, very coldly, was relieved. He said, "It's too early to start a family." But for me, the pain didn't really ease until the following year, when I fell pregnant again. I think we were both a bit surprised, but John was more accepting this time around. Being a biology teacher, he was keen to follow the progress of the pregnancy quite closely. We painted the spare bedroom, bought a cot, and all the other necessities. We had an old chest of drawers that had belonged to my grandfather. We painted it white to give it a fresh look and began choosing names. As it got closer to the expected date of delivery, we packed a bag in readiness for the short ride to the hospital. However, 2 weeks later, I had to be admitted for inducement. John stayed with me all day, and we played cards on the bump to pass the time. About mid-afternoon, I was told the baby was becoming distressed and was at risk. The doctor advised a C-section, which needed to be performed immediately. John said, "If that's the case, I'm going home." I was distraught and asked, "Why leave now? You've waited all day." At that time, fathers were permitted to be in the delivery room, but they were not allowed in the operating theatre. He said, "There's no point staying if I can't witness the birth." I replied, "The baby'll be born in the next few minutes, and you'll be able to see it soon after." We had chosen not to know the sex in advance of the birth. I was whisked off to theatre, but John went home. I believe he phoned the hospital later to find out what happened, but he didn't visit until the following day and had no regret about leaving me. I was heartbroken. Our first son, Mark, was born on the 23rd of November, 1975. 10 days later, I went home with my baby, and gradually the sadness of being left alone for the birth disappeared as I cradled Mark in my arms and looked forward to the rosy future ahead. Now we really are a family, I thought. As was the usual thing to do at the time, I gave up my job to stay at home and be a full-time mother. I was happy to be at home, washing nappies, and loved my son unconditionally. One day a week, Mam would make the 2-hour journey by bus to visit for the day and help me with the baby. If the weather was good, we'd go for a walk pushing the pram, often going into Consett, a former mining town on the edge of the Pennines, to do some shopping. If it was too cold or wet, she'd help me with some housework or cooking. After a long day at work, Dad would come over by car to take her home. We would speak on the phone every day, but I always looked forward to the days she came to see us. 2 years later, John decided we needed a bigger, more modern home, and so we moved to a newly built 3-bedroom house with central heating and a good-sized back garden in the smart village of Whitton Gilbert on the outskirts of Durham. Around the turn of the year, I was expecting again, and our second son, Anthony, was born on the 3rd of September, 1978. The boys were my life, and I now wanted for nothing. My family was complete. John, however, was becoming progressively more restless. He was increasingly disillusioned with the teaching profession, forever muttering about a lack of standards and lack of discipline in the classroom. But equally important to John was the need to earn more money. He'd even taken a weekend job as a doorman at a local cinema in Hartlepool to earn some extra cash. The years after Anthony's birth were not particularly happy ones. John seemed to have little time for the boys, and hated the fact that I was always nagging him about smoking around them in the house. We began to argue more, but John always seemed to overlook my views. "It's my house, and if I want to smoke, I will," was how he put it. He wouldn't shout, It was always more of a lecture. Through his teacher training, he'd learned how to control disruptive pupils, and that's pretty much how he made me feel at times, a second-year pupil in one of his classes. I would just be talked down to. Whatever John wanted to do, he did, and I reached the stage where it felt pointless even arguing with him. I'd lost touch with my friend Kathleen by now, and felt very isolated. John still had a passion for adventure, and arranged a camping trip in the Lake District with his brother. I'd been looking after the boys on my own all week, and it was the middle of winter, and there was snow on the ground. "You can't go camping in this weather," I said, when he told me about it the week before. "Of course we can," was his reply. "We'll be fine." "You could both freeze to death," I insisted.
"We'll be all right. We've got a camping stove and it'll be good fun. You have no sense of adventure."
He was right. I didn't. I worried about the future for the boys. "You might be buried alive. And what am I supposed to do with the boys when I'm on my own?"
"You can always go to visit your mother. You'll have the car."
There was no way I could talk him out of it. He was going and that was it, whether I liked the idea or not. They went away, but as it turned out, the trip resulted in a row between the two brothers, and it ended earlier than expected. However, it didn't stop them from having more adventures, which involved sailing or cycling together, though they seldom went to plan. I would either spend the time at home on my own with the boys, or sometimes if he left the car, I went to stay with my parents for a few days. In May 1982, I had my first solo adventure with the boys. John's parents took a villa in Spain for a month and invited the four of us to join them during the spring bank holiday week. They were always generous with the boys and enjoyed being part of their lives. They'd invite them to stay for a night or two, and when they visited, they'd often bring a present for them, even if it wasn't a special occasion. I was thrilled that they'd asked us to join them in Spain, but John said it was too far to go for just a week. He arranged one of his excursions with his brother instead. But fortunately for me, his parents arranged for me and the children to join them anyway. It meant flying with the boys on their very first flight and a train journey in Spain to meet Ronnie and Jenny. I was extremely nervous about making the journey, but I didn't want to disappoint my in-laws or the boys. Ronnie was proud to have been able to afford this villa in his retirement. We had a great time. Ronnie didn't enjoy driving very much and didn't want to drive in Spain. I, on the other hand, loved to drive and was very happy when he decided to hire a car, listing me as the named driver. We spent the week exploring the local sights and on the beach with the boys. They enjoyed spending time with their grandparents and the adventure of being on a plane and a train. This was the second time we'd spent a holiday with John's mum and dad, the first one being 2 years earlier in France, when the six of us travelled together by car. John and his dad shared the driving. We'd been joined by John's sister Sheila, Lawrence, a husband, and John's brother David. Anthony celebrated his third birthday during this holiday. It was a happy time. When we returned home from Spain, we found four rabbits in the garden, which John had bought as a surprise for the boys. I didn't know what to make of them at first, but they provided a lot of entertainment and pleasure for us all. Even the rabbits couldn't just have a hutch. They were eventually given a purpose-made rockery to live in, with carefully constructed tunnels, and had the freedom of the garden to roam. John made car tracks over the rockery for the boys to drive their remote-controlled cars over the top. I was pleased he was taking more of an interest in the boys as they were growing older. In winter, he would take them sledging down the steepest hills he could find, and built an igloo in the garden that the boys and the rabbits could explore. We enjoyed family camping holidays in Northumberland and Scotland. One year we went to Wales, but the car broke down and we had to be relayed back home. As the boys grew older, we had several holidays in Brittany, France. They would play on the beach. But while I watched them, John would usually be sat in a deck chair, his nose buried in a book. That was pretty much the state of our marriage for many years. When Anthony was 7, I decided I wanted to go back to work, at least on a part-time basis. And John was only too happy at the prospect of me once again earning some extra money. After 10 years being a full-time mother, I found a job, first as a sales assistant at Marks & Spencer, and then at Boots. They were both temporary positions. About 6 months later, I started work as a part-time receptionist at Giles Gate Medical Centre in Durham. Soon after that, we moved to another, yet again, bigger house in the village. A 4-bedroom home on Glebeside. Being out of the house was a breath of fresh air for me. John, on the other hand, was miserable at work and eventually said he couldn't go on being a teacher for very much longer. He started applying for new jobs. And when a letter arrived one morning in 1990, offering him a position as a financial advisor at Barclays Bank in Newcastle upon Tyne, he took the plunge and resigned after 18 years of teaching. I was happy for him because he'd been so miserable. "If it's what you want, a change will do you good," I reassured him. But it didn't take him long to discover that the grass isn't always greener on the other side. I think he thought a change in career would make everything better, but it didn't. He just didn't take to the bank. He felt he was being asked to sell products to people who didn't really need them or couldn't afford them, and he wasn't prepared to do that. In hindsight, he must have learned a lot about how banks operate, though. He stuck it out for a year, but was pretty unhappy the whole time. He started looking for other jobs and totally surprised me one day when he said he had decided to join the prison service. It was his decision, and I was happy for him. So in 1992, at the age of 42, John embarked on another complete change of career, and after finishing his training, he started work at Home House Prison in Stockton-on-Tees. Like any job, it could be stressful at times, but John seemed to enjoy his work, at least at first. John had dabbled in stocks and shares for years, but only risked small amounts of cash because that was all that was available to him. Retirement was constantly on his mind. He'd long bragged he'd be a millionaire by the time he was 50. But he knew his 2 index-linked pensions would give us the comfortable life he craved. He needed something else. As Mark and Anthony grew older, they were roped in to help with their father's latest money-making schemes. There were 2 in particular that raised eyebrows, the first being garden gnomes. John bought rubber moulds and enlisted the boys to paint the resulting figures in bright colours. He'd then sell them on his stall in Durham Market, or at car boot sales. Later, realising gnomes were never going to make him rich, he tried his hand at breeding snails, having read an article about how you could make a tidy side income in doing so. Needless to say, he made little or no money, and soon decided snails were not for him. When Anthony was aged 15, he began looking for a way of earning some pocket money and applied for a job with a door-to-door catalogue company. He was too young to do it on his own, so the local agent suggested John and I could help with some of the ordering. As time went by, John appeared to be spending a lot of time with the local agent, making up excuses as to why he needed to see her. I began to be suspicious, which came to a head when John said he needed to go away to a weekend conference with the woman. I asked outright if he was having an affair. "Is there something going on between you two?" He denied it. "Don't be ridiculous. We're going to a conference, and she's taking her daughter with her," he said, and went away regardless. But I knew in my heart something was going on. I could see it in their eyes when they looked at each other.
There was a glint in John's eyes that I hadn't seen in a long time. He didn't look at me in that way anymore. I could see my marriage dissolving in front of my eyes, and I decided I had to do something if I wanted to save it. I didn't want it to end, and I realised I had to fight to keep us together. So one day I decided to go to the woman's house and confront her. I drove to the nearby village where she lived and knocked on the door. When she answered, I was shocked. I'd met her several times before and noticed immediately that her once blonde curly hair had been straightened and dyed almost the same colour as mine. At first she denied there was anything going on with John. She said they had decided to set up another business together, selling items for personal protection, personal alarms, pepper spray, and some noxious spray that gave off a horrid odour that was impossible to wash off. According to her, she had the ideas, and John had the ability to make the business work. I guess he thought he'd found a kindred spirit and became infatuated with her. I said to her, it was plain by the way they looked at each other and the amount of time they spent together that they were more than business partners. Eventually, she confessed to having an affair. We didn't shout. I didn't even raise my voice. But I felt I had made a stand. I went home to make tea for the boys and was ironing when John arrived home that evening. I told him what I'd done, leaving him with little option but to admit that it was true. Even then, despite his assurances to the contrary, the affair carried on for some weeks. It was only when the woman's husband found out and came to our house and confronted John, warning him in no uncertain terms to keep away, that John realised he had to end the relationship. I didn't get involved, but I was in the next room and could hear the argument. John knew I could hear it too. Of course, I was angry and heartbroken and thought about leaving him, particularly when I realised the affair had been going on despite John's promises. But married life was all I'd known for nearly 20 years. I doubted my ability to cope on my own, and I worried about what effect it would have on the boys if we separated. One evening, at John's instigation, we sat down and started to examine where things had gone wrong in our marriage. I was shocked when John confessed to having had another affair soon after we married. I realised I didn't even want to be with him anymore, but was still worried about the impact on the boys and how I would cope on my own. Where would I live? Who would the boys live with? I didn't want to see the boys hurt, and the last thing I wanted was to tear the family apart. I felt I'd failed as a wife. In turmoil, I felt totally trapped. It was without doubt the lowest point of my life so far. After much soul-searching, I eventually forgave him. My marriage vows were for better for worse, till death do us part, and I wanted to honour them. We agreed to make a fresh start, where we'd both make more of an effort and try to make things work. However, I wasn't sure if I'd ever be able to trust him again. Chapter 3. Get Rich Quick. John always knew that while his part-time sidelines helped pay the bills, they would never make him a wealthy man. He remembered his father telling him, "You couldn't go wrong with bricks and mortar," and decided to turn his attention to building a mini property empire. It was the mid-1990s when he started investing in this latest get-rich-quick venture. The first house he bought was in the historic market town of Chesterley Street, which he suggested would provide me with an alternative to a pension. It had four bedrooms, and we converted a downstairs room to make five in total. The rooms were let to mostly young, unemployed people. John thought it would provide us with a steady income, as they were claiming housing benefit, which could be paid directly to us as landlords.
Within the space of a year, he'd bought 11 more houses, this time in poor former mining villages. Five of them were among the cheapest homes in the village of Easington, where pit owners had been notorious for providing the most basic housing they could get away with. John liked to boast that he bought one on a credit card for £6,000. There were simple two-up, two-down brick terrace properties. There was a sitting room at the front of the house with a small kitchen and bathroom extension at the back, and two bedrooms upstairs. Easington had been devastated by the demise of the mining industry, which in 1951 employed 81,000 people in the county. Those jobs had simply vanished, leaving appalling levels of economic, social, and environmental deprivation and rising crime rates. This was where John foolishly believed his rental homes would make him a millionaire. It was easy money, he bragged. I was far from sure. I thought it was too much to take on. I already wasn't happy dealing with the tenants in the house we rented out in Chesterley Street. The income John was expecting was slow to arrive, as the tenants wouldn't complete the necessary application forms for housing benefit. There was a constant change of tenants, as they never seemed to agree with one another, and they had no idea about how to care for themselves or the property. We'd spent a long time preparing the house, and it was upsetting to see the way it was being treated. All I could foresee was a huge multiplication of our problems happening in Easington. John reasoned that they would be different, because he would look for couples or young families as the houses only had two bedrooms. As with all his ventures, John relied on working out everything on a spreadsheet and then producing it as evidence. It's plain to see. It's there in black and white. I've looked at every possibility, he'd say. He did manage to get a few houses let to long-term tenants that gave us no hassle. If only it could have been the same for all of them. We were spending less and less time together. We were either at work or John was doing repairs on the houses. He tried to do as much as possible by himself to save unnecessary expense. Then he got frustrated with me because I couldn't help out. By this time, I had two jobs. I worked 25 hours as senior receptionist at the surgery, and I did two evenings a week, finishing at midnight, in addition to one full day on a weekend at the out-of-hours centre for GPs. I enjoyed the work, the responsibility of making sure everything was prepared for the next day's surgery and helping patients at their most vulnerable. We had angry people to deal with as well, disappointed that they couldn't get an appointment immediately. But there was always a way to spot those genuinely in need so we could sort things out for them there and then. It was very rewarding. Obviously, it gave us some extra income too, but I certainly didn't have time for maintenance on the rental properties. With John working shifts, we were often like ships passing in the night. We'd never had much of a social life. John once joked to someone that he only took me out when it was voting night. I kept my sanity by singing in a local choir and the occasional meal out with the girls from the surgery. It was late summer or early autumn 2000 when John announced he had found the perfect seafront home for us in nearby Seaton Carew. I was very happy where we were. I didn't want to move. We'd just got our own house the way we wanted it, and I felt we'd put down roots in Wittenagilbert. Although the move would mean a much shorter journey to work for John, it wouldn't be practical for me to do my second job. Our home was big enough for our needs. Anthony had already left to find work near to his girlfriend Louise, and I knew it was likely that Mark would also soon move away. I was shocked to discover he also wanted us to buy the property next door. Numbers 3 and 4 The Cliff were in a row of five majestic Victorian terraced houses, he told me, with magnificent views over the sea. They'd been built in the 1890s, so local legend had it, for the five daughters of a wealthy industrialist. Next door, but just far enough away to block out the noise from departing guests, was the town's best-known hotel, the Staincliffe, built in the same Gothic style by the same wealthy pillar of the community. Still, John persuaded me to visit the houses to see for myself. I took one look and thought, he must be crazy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.